وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا الى يوم الدين اما بعد. الحمد لله, we're in the first week of the month of Ramadan, and normally when Ramadan comes around there's an increase in nasiha and counseling, there's an increase in advices and lectures and bayans that we receive. One of the things which are very beneficial is to actually see how certain people established the deen and the religion in their lives. One is that we hear a hadith or a Quranic verse and we process it for ourselves and we try to imbibe it within ourselves. Another way is to see how others have reflected over the Sharia, the Quran and the Sunnah, and how they have adopted the message, how they've personalized it, and how they've used it to lead their life and to guide themselves in their lifestyle. I think that's actually very beneficial because we can actually then see how somebody acts on the deen. We hear the stories of the Sahaba. The benefit that we receive from listening or reading about the Sahaba is how they took the deen and how they understood it and how they actually established it in their life. Then there were the Tabi'een, and then there were the people that followed them. I just want to speak about just one incident today, one exchange actually, a dialogue between two very prominent individuals. One was prominent in the sense that he was the Khalif of the Muslimin. He was the Khalif of the Muslim Ummah at the time. Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, an Umayyad, one of the Umayyad Khalifs, the one who was the Khalif just before Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz became the Khalif, rahimahullah. The son of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. His name was Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. In 97 after Hijrah, Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, he went to the holy sanctuaries, Makkah Mukarramah, Medina Munawwara. When he got to Medina Munawwara, they set up his caravan there. Now he's the Khalif. Now you know the Umayyads, they had made their Darul Khilafah in Damascus. Ali radiallahu anhu's Darul Khilafah was, you could say, Kufa to a certain degree after Medina Munawwara. But when it came to the Umayyads, from Muawiyah radiallahu anhu thereafter, Damascus in Syria was their center of caliphate. Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, he had actually been in Gaza and Palestine as well. But in 97 Hijri, he went to Medina Munawwara. They set up his camp there. And as soon as the camp was set up, all of the respectful big people from around, in and around Medina Munawwara, they came to visit him. They came to see him. They came to make salam with him. So he welcomed them. He spoke to them. After a while, after Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, after he had finished with them, and he had welcomed them and spoken to them, he said to some of his companions, he said, the hearts, they become corroded, become rusty, just like metal ore becomes rusty. Now you have to understand that he's coming to Medina Munawwara for a reason. When a person comes to Medina Munawwara, the hearts normally melt. And we have to give it to these khalifs of the past. Despite whatever we hear about them and we say about them and what history documents about them, they seem to have had a piety which is not always found in necessarily the leaders of today, at least not openly. When you hear this exchange and this dialogue, you'll see that there was humility in this speech. There was a want and a desire to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's almost like this Khalif is in this position as a Khalif with all of the riches and the indulgence and everything. A tradition that he's come through. The Umayyads were known to be really indulgent people. After Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, after some of the good ones, they were known to be very indulgent people. Walid ibn Abd al-Malik. There's a lot of controversy about these individuals. But in fact there's a difference of opinion among ulama, this whole contention among the ulama as to whether the Abbasids were greater than the Umayyads, or were the Umayyads greater. And there's long debates about this in history as well. The Abbasids, they followed the Umayyads, and many people, they say that the Abbasids had a better khilafah. But yet there were problems in the Abbasids as well. The Umayyads had some problems as well. There's even some governors known, because you know the governors and the khalifs, they would be the ones to come and lead the prayer. They would be the imam of the Muslimin as well. The most rightful person to lead the salat in the masjid is the imam of the Muslimin, which means the khalif. So one of them, a governor of one of the khalifs, he came for Fajr prayer and he was drunk. So we've even had that. I mean, you think it's bad today? You think it's bad today? I mean, we've had a person who's the khalif or the governor, he's drunk, he's come to lead the Fajr prayer. And nobody can say anything. In many cases, what happened is, one of the governors, he used to, the Eid khutbah, the Eid al-Fitr khutbah is normally given after the Salat. Traditionally, that's the Sunnah. He would give it before. And the reason for that is, if he gave it afterwards, nobody would sit. They didn't want to listen to him, so then he gave it before, and he would extend it so people would have to sit and listen, because they have to make the salat. So then we've had all sorts of cases in the past. Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik is considered normally to be a much nicer one, nicer khalif. And he says, after he meets everybody, he says, you know, the hearts, they normally feel, they get rusty, just like metal ore becomes rusty. Is there anybody here that can... Actually, what he said is that hearts become rusty, and that's why they need, from time to time, they need somebody to come and clean it, to remind it, to counsel it, so that that rust and that corrosion could be eliminated. It has to be cleaned once in a while. So they said, yes, of course, there is, you know, we can call somebody who can come and speak to you, who can give you some advice. We can call someone. He said, isn't there in Medina Munawwara somebody who's met the Sahaba, who's lived with the Sahaba? Because this was the time of the Tabi'een. We're talking about 97 Hijri. There were maybe one or two Sahaba left at that time. Anas ibn Malik, he died around this time. There was one that died after him. But that was it. They had lived for a very long time. But after it was all the Tabi'een, meaning the people who'd seen who had seen the Sahaba. So he said, is there somebody in Medina Munawwara who's met a group of the Sahaba, who's benefited from them, and who can come and give us some nasiha, give us some advice, who can remind us? They said, yes, of course, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, there is Abu Hazim, the disabled one, Al-A'raj, the one who's got a problem in his leg, Abu Hazim. He said, who's Abu Hazim? He'd never heard of Abu Hazim al-A'raj. Who is Abu Hazim al-A'raj? So they explained that his name, that was his title. Abu Hazim was his title. His name was Salama ibn Dinar. And he was considered the alim of Medina Munawwara and the imam of Medina Munawwara. So he was a major scholar of Medina Munawwara. And they said that he was one of the tabi'een, one of those people who had met a number of the great Sahaba. So Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik said, yes, go and call him. Call him for us. But when you call him, be gentle in your calling him. Don't kind of summon him as though the king and the ruler is just summoning somebody to, like a criminal or something. Talattafu bih. You know, go and be gentle with him when you summon him. So they went and they called him over. When he came, firstly, the king, he welcomed him. He sat him very close and treated him very nicely. But then he said to him in this kind of mock anger as such, he said, Ma hadha al-jafa ya Aba Hazim? What is this estrangement? What is this aversion of Abu Hazim? Why didn't you come to meet us? Why didn't you come to see us? Everybody else has come. You didn't come. Why are you staying so far away from me? You know when you kind of tell somebody off in a fond, kind of nice, mock anger kind of way? Like, what's wrong with you? Like, why haven't you met me for so long? So look at the answer. You see, this is what we need to focus on today, is the exchange between the two. This is a khalif. He just has to give an order and your head will be off, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so wills. And the Umayyads were known for that. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf was known, as you know, he was a governor of the Umayyads. So, Ma hadha al-jafa ya Aba Hazim? What is this aversion of Abu Hazim? Why are you staying away, Abu Hazim? So, Abu Hazim says to him, Wa ayyu jafa'in ra'ayta minni ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? What kind of aversion have you noticed from me, O Amir al-Mu'mineen? Where is the aversion? What aversion do you speak about, O Amir al-Mu'mineen? So he says, Zarani wujuhun nas, walam tazurni. The main elect people of Medina Munawwara, the great, great people of Medina Munawwara, they came and they visited me and you did not visit me? So Abu Hazim says, really coolly, he says, إِنَّمَا يَكُونُ الْجَفَاءُ بَعْدَ الْمَعْرِفَةِ. Aversion can only be after recognition. Aversion can only be once you get to know someone. When you don't know someone, how can you say that you're avoiding me? I don't know you anyway. وَأَنْتَ مَا عَرَفْتَنِي قَبْلَ الْيَوْمِ. You did not know about me before this day. Before this day, you had no idea about me. وَلَا أَنَا رَأَيْتُكَ. And neither have I ever seen you before. فَأَيُّ جَفَاءٍ وَقَعَ مِنِّي. So what kind of aversion has ensued from me? The Khalifa said to the people around him, I remember this is not in a private gathering. This is not a private one-to-one discussion. In that way, you know, you could get away with much more. But here the Khalifa has to also look at his position. He has to see what people are going to be thinking. Imagine you were in that position, a respectable person of the community, and somebody came and responded to you that way. What would you do? We have to save our face, we become defensive. But I have to give it to this Khalifa, look at his response. He told the people around him, he said, أصاب الشيخ في اعتذاره. The Shaykh is absolutely right in his excuse. He is absolutely right in his excuse. وَأَخْطَأَ الْخَلِيفَ وَأَخْطَأَ الْخَلِيفَ فِي عَتْبِهِ عَلَيْهِ. And the Khalifa is wrong in telling him off. So just in case anybody had any doubt about that, he makes it very clear that the Khalifa is wrong in telling him off. It was mock anger anyway to start with. Then he turned to Abu Hazim and he said, he got to the point. He said, إِنَّ فِي النَّفْسِ شُؤُونًا أَحْبَبْتُ أَنْ أَقْضِي بِهَا إِلَيْكَ يَا أَبَا حَازِمٍ. I have some feelings in the heart, some tremblings in the heart, some turbulence in the heart, which I would like to bring to your attention, O Abu Hazim. هَاتِهَا يَا أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ. Abu Hazim said, bring it up, bring it forth, tell it to me. Allah is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sought for his assistance. Allah is the best of helpers. So the Khalifa said, O Abu Hazim, the first question he asked him, and look at this question, look at the answer. And I think we can all reflect over this. Yes, this is all addressed to the Khalif, but believe me, we live like Khalifs today. In terms of what we're speaking about here, we live like Khalifs. We manage our affairs. We have disposable income. We can get whatever we want 24 hours a day. In fact, we probably have more facility today than the Khalif probably had at that time. And much more easily today. We can shop any time of the day, 24 hours a day. If you pay enough, you can get the product the next day. Right? So, a lot of this relates to us. And we need to, this is not just about a story that we is here to enthuse us. That whole idea of this is to reflect so that we can derive some lessons from this in this month of Ramadan and make this as part of our target and our objective to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. He asked him a question. He said, مَا لَنَا نَكْرَهُ الْمَوْتِ. Why is it that we hate death? Who likes death? Who's ready for his death right now? We all know and acknowledge that we will die one day. And it's something we've taken for granted that it will happen. But which one of us is actually prepared for our death? That if we're told that we're going to die tomorrow, we wouldn't do anything differently. Because we're already set. Everything is in motion. All debts are cleared. That we're already all taken care of. مَا لَنَا نَكْرَهُ الْمَوْتِ. Why is it that we dislike death? Abu Hazim instantly, he says, لِأَنَّا عَمَّرْنَا دُنْيَانَا وَخَرَّبْنَا آخِرَتَنَا فَنَكْرَهُ الْخُرُوجِ مِنَ الْعُمَّارِ إِلَى الْخَرَابِ. The reason for that is very simple. The reason is that we have populated, inhabited our dunya. We've adorned it and embellished it. We've gone to great extremes to make it the place of comfort and luxury for us. وَخَرَّبْنَا آخِرَتَنَا. And we have made desolate our akhirah. We've been given a promised piece of land in the hereafter. As the hadith mentions, إِنَّهَا قِيْعَانِ. It is an empty piece of land. And the غَرْسُهَا, which means its plantation, its plants, and what you're going to sow in there is the subhanAllah, the tasbih. We have to inhabit the land of the hereafter. He's saying that this world of ours, the closer world, the nearer abode, we have inhabited that. We've embellished it, we've adorned it. And we've really made it beautiful for ourselves. And the hereafter, we've made it desolate. There's nothing there for us. The weeds are growing as such. فَنَكْرَهُ الْخُرُوجِ مِنَ الْعُمَّارِ إِلَى الْخَرَابِ. And thus, we totally dislike leaving an inhabited place for a desolate place. Imagine if today, I mean, we hear about, in the media, we hear that there are places in America before the boom in China, they made all of these big cities. And these cities are totally empty, nobody there to buy it. Because the bust came and it just didn't take off. Imagine you were given those houses for £50 each. Go live there. Why would you want to go and live there? Right? Even for us here, I mean, the reason why we stick around in these areas is because we've got a masjid, we've got many things that are inhabited. We've worked hard to inhabit these things. If we're told to go to another place that's desolate, we're not going to do it. But what about if you know you're going to have to go there? In this case, it's a choice that we stay in London, East London. We stay there. Or we move out further and get a bigger house, right? Maybe get a better lifestyle than all of the traffic and everything. We've got an option. We can stay here and die here, or we could move. But what about if we are told that there is another place that you're going to have to go to? One day you're definitely going to have to go there. You're only here for a certain time. Then it would be quite crazy, and it would be quite insane that we don't work to do something at least there, that the day when it comes that we have to leave and go there, at least we've got something to go towards. Otherwise, we'll have to redo everything, if we even get there. And that's the problem, that's the thought here. That we have made our world, mashallah, so beautiful, that we hate to leave it, so that we could go to the hereafter. Because we haven't focused, the hereafter is not a conscious thing in our mind yet. The people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're focused on the hereafter. So they make this place, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kun fi dunya ka annaka gharibun wa 'abiru sabil." Be in this world as though you're a traveler or a wayfarer. So they've got the few things together that they have, but the hereafter is what they're sending everything forward to. This was a very straightforward answer. So the Khalifa said, "Sadaqt, you've told the absolute truth." Then after that, he said, "Oh Abu Hazim, layda sha'ri ma lana 'inda Allahi ghadan." I'm really concerned. What is our consequence in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tomorrow? What will we receive in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tomorrow? Look at the answer he gives him. He says, أَعْرِضْ عَمَلَكَ عَلَىٰ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَ. Take your actions and your deeds, your behavior, and put it in front of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put it in front of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you will find what you will discover in the hereafter tomorrow. You will find what your result will be in the hereafter. So Abu Hazim, the Khalif says, وَأَيْنَ أَجِدْهُ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Which ayah do you speak about? Which verses are you telling me to compare my actions to? So he says, تَجِدْهُ فِي قَوْلِهِ. You'll find it where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ لَفِي نَعِيمٍ وَإِنَّ الْفُجَّارَ لَفِي جَحِيمٍ. That verily the good and the pious people will be in bounties. Jannatul Na'im will be in the bounties of paradise, and the disobedient ones, the transgressors, will be in the hellfire. Take our actions. Do we qualify as obedient and pious people and righteous people, or do we qualify as sinners? And that there is your answer, he says. The Khalifa says then, so where is the mercy of Allah then? فَأَيْنَ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ. You know, we all hear Allah Rahim, Allah Ghafoor. So there's many people who actually do sins openly and they say Allah Rahim. Allah is merciful. Allah is compassionate. And there's no doubt about that. But this blatant act of perpetration of wrong, while in the back of your mind, Allah's forgiving, He's forgiving, He's okay, He's soft. That's the attitude. It's like, for example, you're at work, you have an employer, and some other employee wants to do something wrong, maybe take something home or slack off work or something. So you tell him, no, that's wrong. He says, well, he doesn't really, he's too soft anyway. Right? What are you going to think? Isn't that the attitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do you mean when you say Allah is forgiving? That he's so soft that, you know, I can call my shots. I can do what I like and he's going to forgive me anyway. Where's the guarantee? Allah is definitely all forgiving. But there are conditions for that. There is a heart that's needed for that. repentance, remorse. So أَيْنَ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ? Where is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He must have found the answer to be very blatant, very straightforward, very strict. So where's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Abu Hazim said, again from the Quran, إِنَّ رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ مِّنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. That verily the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well close to the doers of good. So those who do good will have the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Khalifa says, لَيْتَ شَعْرِي كَيْفَ الْقُدُومُ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ غَدًا. Now the Khalifa is getting really softened out. He's getting really concerned. He says, لَيْتَ شَعْرِي كَيْفَ الْقُدُومُ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Woe be upon me. How will our approach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be tomorrow? How will our confrontation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be tomorrow? So Abu Hazim said, أَمَّا الْمُحْسِنُ. As far as the doer of good is concerned, فَكَالْغَائِبِ يَقْدُمُ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ. The person who does good, the doer of good, he'll be like the one who's gone for a holiday and he's dying to get back home. He's been away for a month. He wants to see his wife and his children. And he finally comes back home. And can you imagine the pleasure and the satisfaction and the happiness that he gets when he gets back home, and now he's safely back with his family. He hugs them and he brings them close to him. So the person who is a doer of good in this world, that is the same experience that he will have in the hereafter when he gets there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that experience in the hereafter. May Allah make us of those people who get that experience of the muhsineen. وَأَمَّا الْمُسِيِّ. And as far as the evil person is concerned, the person who is always transgressing, فَكَالْعَبْدِ الْهَارِبِ. He will be like the slave who's run away. The runaway slave. يُسَاقُ إِلَىٰ مَوْلَاهُ سَوْقًا. The one who is then found, who is then captured, and he is pulled and dragged to his master. That here you go, this is your runaway slave. فَبَكَ الْخَلِيفَ. Now the Khalifa began to cry at this. His heart is totally softened out. All his pretenses, or any arrogance if there was any, has gone. He begins to weep in front of everybody, hatta ala nahyu, until his lamenting became very loud. So he wasn't crying in this manner to hide himself. He was clearly and open. It was his time to do that. Washtadda buka'u. His crying became very intense. Then he said, Oh Abu Hazim, kayfa lana an nuslih? How can we reform ourselves? Give us a way to reform ourselves, to make ourselves better, to enhance ourselves, to correct ourselves. قَالَ تَدَعُونَ عَنْكُمْ التَّكَبُّرُ. Abu Hazim, penetrating insight. فَصَاحَ فِي الْكَلَامِ. Penetrating insight, absolutely eloquent speech, short pithy statements that hit the mark. This is exactly what Abu Hazim is doing. Absolutely no fear whatsoever. Just giving the Khalif what he wants. As the perfect doctor that is administrating that bitter medicine and knows how to administrate it. That is Abu Hazim. So he says to him, تَدَعُونَ عَنْكُمْ التَّكَبُّرُ. You will abandon from yourself all forms of arrogance and pride that you're better than anybody else. You'll take that away from yourself. وَتَتَحَلَّوْنَ بِالْمُرُوءَةِ. And you will embellish yourself with chivalry, with modesty, with honor, with generosity. مُرُوءَةِ. Which means a sense of honor when you deal with other people. Not this sense of arrogance when you deal with others. But a sense of honor, decency, chivalry. That's what you have to adorn yourself with. Then the Khalifa says, وَهَذَا الْمَالِ. Recognizing that a lot of the problems come because of the wealth that you have. The indulgence, as I said, the Umayyads were known for their indulgence. So Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, he says, وَهَذَا الْمَالِ مَا السَّبِيلُ إِلَىٰ تَقْوَى اللَّهِ فِيهِ. This wealth that we have, what is the way of taqwa in it? What is the way to deal with this wealth with taqwa, with God-fearingness? Oh Abu Hazim. Abu Hazim says, إِذَا أَخَذْتُمُوهُ بِحَقِّهِ وَوَضَعْتُمُوهُ فِي أَهْلِهِ. If you have taken it from the rightful person that it needs to be taken from, and then you've distributed it in the people who are entitled for it, that is what the right of it is. Because the Umayyads were known to, they were known, like when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz became the Khalif after Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, he immediately set up a gathering. In fact, the whole night was engaged in the burial of Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik's children were too young to become the next Khalif. Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz was a cousin. He was not one of the children of Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, the previous Khalif. He was not in the line of descent of their line of descent. They made it kind of a monarchic Khilafah as such, where they would just pass it on to their family. So the children were not old enough. One of the children, he tried to put long clothing on him to make him look taller so that maybe he would be chosen, but it didn't work. There was a scholar who was one of his advisors. Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik was a nice man, generally. There was a scholar who was one of his advisors, so he whispered in his ears that your cousin, Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this situation. He whispered in his ears, so Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, that's how he was chosen to become the next Khalif. Not by default. He was chosen. Then it was agreed that he would be the next Khalif, and after that he would go back into his family. So Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz spends the whole night in this burial. Next morning, he hasn't slept. He gives a khutbah after Fajr. In fact, after he leaves the burial ground, he just looks behind him and suddenly he sees the chief of the police, the chief of the army with this large entourage. He turns around to them and he says, I won't be needing this anymore. You're relieved, you don't need to do this anymore. So then he gets to the masjid, he gives a khutbah, and he gives his inauguration khutbah as such, that I'm responsible for you now, pious khutbah he delivered. And then after that, he left to go and take a nap. And as he was going inside, his son comes along. And he says to his father, oh father, where are you going? He says, I've been awake all night. I need to take a rest. He said, what happens if you die before them? He says, I'll go back after Dhuhr and I'll make, then we'll carry on. We'll carry on the judgments and people's grievances. He says, people are out there with grievances. They want to speak to you about many things that have happened in the Khalifs of the past. They want you to set right the wrongs that have been committed before. He says, I'll do it after Dhuhr, I'm very tired. He says, what happens if you don't live until Dhuhr? Then what? So Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz grabs his son. Imagine if your son said that to you. If he set you aright, how would you feel? Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz hugs him and embraces him. And he praises Allah, he says, all praises to Allah who gave me a son like this who can set me right. He went back and he sat down. And there you go, people were complaining, so-and-so khalif or so-and-so governor. They took this piece of land, they did this, they did this. And Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz just started giving everything back. He took all of the jewelry that his wife was one of the sisters of Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. She was from the royal family. He took all of her jewelry away, put it in the Baytul Mal. She was a woman of great understanding as well. She stayed up with him like that. Eventually, Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz was poisoned. But going back to Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, who was one of the nicer ones among them, he says, this is the way of taqwa. So he's explaining this is the way of taqwa, that as long as you take it with its rights, and then you disseminate it, you distribute it to the people who are entitled. وَقَسَمْتُمُوهُ بِالسَّوِيَّةِ وَعَدَلْتُمْ فِيهِ بَيْنَ الرَّعِيَّةِ. And you will distribute it fairly and justly. And you need to be just among the populace, among your subjects. The Khalifa then said, O Abu Hazim, أخبرني عن أفضل الأعمال. An أفضل الناس. Tell me about the most superior among people. Who is the best of people? He says, أولو المروءة والتقى. The people who are best in terms of self-honor and dignity and taqwa. And the reason why those two things are mentioned, he's mentioned, is when you're a person of dignity and honor, you will treat others well. So your relationship with others will be with respect, with dignity. You will treat people not with arrogance. And tuqa, your responsibility with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be one of goodness, because you will be fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the secret, that if a person wants the best of character, have muru'ah and have taqwa. And that is the best in terms of interaction with others and our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Khalifa says, وَمَا أَعْدَلُ الْقَوْلِ يَا أَبَا حَازِمُ. What is the most just speech? What is the most just speech? What is the speech that holds the most justice, O Abu Hazim? And look at what he says. Without an iota of fear. كَلِمَةُ حَقٍ يَقُولُهَا الْمَرْءُ عِنْدَ مَنْ يَخَافُ وَعِنْدَ مَنْ يَرْجُو. A word of truth that is said by somebody in front of someone who he fears or in front of someone who he has some hopes in. Think of that very carefully. When is you're fearful of someone that if you say something wrong, then they can do something wrong to you. I mean, in the case of the Khalif, he may kill you, he may imprison you. In the case today, they may demote you. They may knock off your marks. They may throw you out. They may not vote for you tomorrow. These are all possible manifestations. You're fearful of the people, and that's why you say it. Or عند من يرجو, which means, or you have some hope, an ulterior motive. You feel that this person can benefit you. You want that promotion from that person. You want their votes. You want that money that comes from that person, that gift that they normally give you, the favors that they normally show you. So you're not willing to say the truth in front of them. You will hide the truth and you will act hypocritically in front of them. This man is, subhanAllah, so eloquent. He's just got it all right. He understands. He's got the answers ready. He's not sitting there thinking, oh, and then he gives an answer. He knows what he's speaking about. These are the people of Allah. The people of Allah are people who have it crystal clear in their mind as to what the right and wrong is. And the highest manifestation of that among the Ummah was Umar Farooq. That's why he's called the Farooq radiallahu anhu. Absolute criterion, no confusion. Can you see any confusion in this man's words? Crystal clear, he knows exactly what it is. Varied questions, questions ranging on all sorts of topics. His answers are very clear and immediate. Then the Khalifa says, فَمَا أَسْرَعُ الدُّعَاءِ إِجَابَةً يَا أَبَا حَازِمٍ. What is the fastest dua to be accepted, oh Abu Hazim? Which dua will be answered the fastest? Dua al-muhsin lil-muhsin. Dua of a good person for other good people. Dua al-muhsin lil-muhsineen. Dua of one good person for other good people. That's the fastest of the du'as. He's not saying that other du'as will not be accepted. For example, the du'a for an evil person. He's not saying it's not going to be accepted. The question is that which is the fastest of the du'as to be accepted. And the reason for that is quite clear. The ulama have mentioned that, and that in fact it's in a hadith. The hadith mentions in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, don't just make du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you have trouble, when you need something from Allah, but make du'a in good times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then recognize your voice. Allah will recognize our voice regardless. But this is just to make a point, that it's a familiar voice. This person is always asking, I know how to give him, I'll give him. He's always asking, I'll give him even in bad times. We should not just come to the masjid. We should not just sit in lectures when we have trouble, when we've got a court case, when we've just had an accident, when we've got a problem at work, when we've got a problem with our children, when you got a problem with our parents, then we rush to the masjid to get that kind of boost for that moment, and then bye-bye, then it's all gone, then it's all finished. I mean, that's the way the munafiqeen, the mushrikeen used to do things. When they're in the middle of the ocean, they call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, affirming His Lordship. Yet they are absolute polytheists. But when they're in that state, something overcomes them, their nature speaks, and they begin to say that, yes, Allah is our Lord. As soon as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes them to the bank, they think it's some other kind of miracle. They think that it's some other. I mean, subhanAllah, on a lesser scale, this is what we do. That when we start making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we only need Him. And that is something wrong. So that's why he said the fastest of du'as to be accepted is a dua of a good person, a pious person for other pious people. Then he says, the Khalifa says, وَمَا أَفْضَلُ الصَّدَقَةِ. What's the best charity that you could give? He said, جُهْدُ الْمُقِلِّ يَضَعُهُ فِي يَدِ الْبَائِسِ الْفَقِيرِ مِنْ غَيْرِ أَنْ يَطْبَعُهُ مَنَّا وَلَا أَذَى. Look how clear this answer is, the clarity in his understanding. He says, the best of sadaqah is that one which is given after great effort by the person who doesn't have much to start with. جُهْدُ الْمُقِلِّ. It's a juhd, it's an effort by the muqil, the one who has very little. Right? It's the one given by the one who has very little, after great effort, and then he goes and puts it in the hand. Right? He goes and puts it in the hand, so he's not waiting for that person to come to ask him. His words are phrased so well that they every part means something. So he says he goes and puts it in the hand of a needy, poor person, and then it is not followed up by any reminders or any harm. hey, I gave you, you know, I give you all that sadaqah every year. I give you all that money every year. What's your problem with you? Why can't you support me now? Why can't you vote for me now? Why can't you, you know, be on my side? Why can't you defend me? You know, whatever the story is. Man means to go and remind a person that you've given something to. Hey, I did that for you. Now, it's permissible in the case where somebody is a total ungrateful jerk, where you give them things and they're just being ungrateful, absolute, you know, for no reason whatsoever. Then you can say, I mean, you know, what kind of an ungrateful person are you, right? If you want to. But in any other case where it's just a poor faqir, I mean, you don't go and remind them. Then the Khalifa said, "Man akyasu an-nas ya Abu Hazim, who is the most intelligent of people, O Abu Hazim?" He said, "Rajulun dhafar bi ta'ati Allahi ta'ala fa amila biha, thumma dalla an-nas 'alayha." That the person who has succeeded in being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's overcome himself. He's left his time of jahiliyyah. He's overcome himself and now he's in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he's practicing upon it, and then he goes and he guides others to it as well. With hikmah, with wisdom. Many people, when they come right after being wrong, then they become so strong about it that they become military about it. They have like a little army with them and they go and, you know, like want to break everybody down. I mean, it took you so many years, so why do you do that for other people? One needs to recognize that, then things need to be done with wisdom. You need to try. Then the Khalifa said, who's the worst of the people? Who's the most stupid person? Ahmakun nas, the most foolish of people. Listen to this one carefully. Because this is something that many of the weak ones among us who don't think for themselves will do. People who just follow football and don't think themselves. Sorry for that. I'm talking about people who have no intelligence. Their whole life is football. Or their whole life is something else. Frivolous activity. You know, one is that, okay, you've got some interest, but the other one is that that's only your interest. That's all you do. Your wife complains because you're sitting watching on highlights 3 hours a day. Poor woman. Right? May Allah have mercy on her. May Allah rectify the husband. We get questions like this, subhanAllah. My husband sits for 3 hours watching football. Come on, man. SubhanAllah. So he says, رَجُلٌ إِن سَرَقَ مَعَ هَوَى صَاحِبِهِ. Especially those who are in a crew all the time, who like to be with people, with a clique, who like to, you know, always be with their friends. Even if they don't want to be with them, they have to be with them because they've just got themselves in that circumstance. A person who gets pulled by the desires of his companion, a person who gets attracted and dragged along by the desires of his companion, وَصَاحِبُهُ ظَالِمٌ, while his companion is an oppressor, he's a wrongdoer, but he gets pulled along with him. So, essentially what Abu Hazim is saying, فَبَاعَ آخِرَتَهُ بِالدُّنْيَا غَيْرِهِ. So he has sold his akhirah for the dunya of someone else. Think about that. One is that you do your own indulgence, right? And you sell your akhirah for your own indulgence, which is bad enough. But at least you got the pleasure. This one is that it's for somebody else's bidding, for somebody else's desires. We're just tagging along with them. We feel that we have to compel to do it, and we're selling our akhirah because we're not going to pray salah because they want to go out to the club tonight, they want to go and commit haram. We don't really want to be there, but you want to be part of it because you want to seem cool, you know, because you get certain benefits of being in there, whatever the case is. May Allah protect us. So you're selling your akhirah for somebody else's desire. Then the Khalifa said, Khalifa seems to have finished his questions, but then he notices the spark in this man, the spark in this alim. And he says to him, and he thinks to himself, I must stay with this man. How do I stay with him? How can I get him to stay with me? Right? This is a jewel, this is a pearl. I mean, subhanAllah, he's a straight shooter. He tells it as it is, and it affects the heart. The Khalifa says, هَلَّنَا أَن تَصْحَبَنَا يَا أَبَا حَزِمْ فَتُصِيبَ مِنَّا وَنُصِيبَ مِنْكَ. Is it possible that you remain in our company? That, you know, you stay with me, because, you know, the Khalifa normally has an entourage. That you remain in our company, I can benefit from you and you can benefit from us. You can benefit from me, I can benefit you, I can help you out whenever you need things, you can, and I can benefit from you. كَلَّا يَا أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. No way, O Amirul Mu'mineen. Absolutely not, he says. كَلَّا, absolutely not. The Khalifa says, وَلِمَا, why not? Why not? أَخْشَى أَنْ أَرْكُنَ إِلَيْكُمْ قَلِيلًا. أخشى أن أركن إليكم قليلا فيذيقني الله ضعف الحياة وضعف الممات. My fear is that if I stayed with you, then I would just slightly become inclined to you and your ways. And then Allah, and look at this, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give me double the world and double the death. Essentially, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, none other than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that had we not strengthened you, had we not kept you steadfast and given you that strength to deal with these challenges, then كِدْتَ تَرْكَنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ شَيْءٍ قَلِيلًا ثُمَّ لَأَذَقْنَاكَ ضِعْفَ الْحَيَاةِ وَضِعْفَ الْمَمَاتِ ثُمَّ لَا تَجِدْ لَكَ عَلَيْنَا نَصِيرًا. This is speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who do we know as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? But Allah is saying that if we had not strengthened you and given you that special tawfiq, then you could have possibly become inclined to them just slightly. Can you imagine all of those challenges that were put in front of him? Oh, we'll believe if you do this for us, we'll believe. What about this, you worship our lords for 1 year, and then we'll worship your lord for another. You know, all of these, they gave him all of these proposals. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very merciful character, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept him steadfast that he was able to deal with all of these things. Abu Hazim uses the same thing. He said, if I stayed with you, then in your company, I would become influenced by you. I would become influenced by your riches. Let me give you an example. You got a new person that comes into town. He's got a really nice car, right? You know, he's got a nice maybe M6 or whatever it's called, right? X6 or whatever it is. You sat in there a few times. What's your desire going to be if you like that car? Your desire is going to be, I want to get one of those as well. Before that, you never dreamt of it. Now you're set in it, you've seen it, you've seen its pickup, you've seen whatever it is, and now you want to get one as well. You sit with somebody, right? You sit with somebody, you've never heard about I'm going maybe high level, but you've never heard about a hand-stitch suit. You've met this new guy at work, and he's going with his hand-stitch suits. And you think like, oh, I can't get Calvin Klein anymore, I must get a special tailor-made, bespoke, all the rest of it. It's just, this is the way the world works. Essentially, that's the way the world works. That's why we've been told to look at people who have less than us so we can be thankful. If we look at people with better things, we're going to want that as well. It's just human nature to do that. And our standards will rise. There's nothing wrong with the standards, it's just the indulgence in the world that it brings about. That's the problem. To have a high standard, if you've Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you money and wealth, to have the standards, as long as you're humble, and as long as you're spending in charity as well, there's nothing wrong with that. The problem is that the arrogance which it normally brings along with it. Because when you have much more, you have more than somebody else, you start thinking you're better than somebody else. You pull up in something, somebody else pulls up in something else. What are you going to think? The way you get out, the way you close your door, the way you press the button. There's a certain thing, you put your glasses out, you need sunglasses with that, and you need a certain type of attitude that goes along with these things. It's just the way of the world, right? Very few people can avoid these things. So I am fearful of that. Then I am fearful then that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then give me double in this world. But then in the hereafter, I'll have problems. Then the Khalifa says, oh Abu Hazim, is there a need that you have? Give me a need. If there's a need that you have, tell me and I'll sort it out for you. Abu Hazim remains silent. This is when he's silenced. No response. So the Khalifa asks him again, irfa ilayna hajatak, whatever need you have, tell me, oh Abu Hazim, naqdiha lak, mahma kanat, wherever it may be, whatever it may be, tell it to us and we'll sort it out for you. We'll give the orders and be done. The Khalifa said, hajati, sorry, the Abu Hazim, he finally responds, he says, hajati an tunqidhani min an-nar, wa tudkhilani al-jannah, my one desire is that you save me from the hellfire. You give me delivery from the hellfire, give me a ticket away from the hellfire. And give me access to paradise. Enter me into paradise. And the Khalifa says, "Laysa min sha'ni." That's not something I can do, oh Abu Hazim. Abu Hazim said, "Mali min hajatin siwaha am ya amir al-mu'minin." I don't have any need besides that, oh amir al-mu'minin. That's my only need. Imagine it. We're in front of somebody who tells us, "What do you want?" This store is open for you. Costco, Asda, if you want. Whatever. Debenhams. Take whatever you want, take this trolley, whatever you can fill up, take it. Absolutely. How many minutes have I got? Subhanallah, subhanallah. Then the Khalifa says, okay, make some dua for me. Make some dua for me. Look at his dua. اللهم immediately اللهم إن كان عبدك سليمان من أوليائك فيسره إلى خيري الدنيا والآخرة وإن كان من أعدائك فأصلحه واهده إلى ما تحب وترضى. Oh Allah, if this servant of yours Sulaiman is from among your close ones, your wali, your awliya, then make the good of this world and the hereafter easy for him and facilitate it for him. And if he is from your enemies, then guide him, reform him towards the path that you love and that you are pleased with. A person who's looking at all of this, who's more khalif than the khalif, right? You know, you get those people, bigger chamchas than the people in there, right? He says, بِسَمَا قُلْتْ مُنْذَ دَخَلْتَ عَلَىٰ أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He was probably being angry all of this time. He was just seething. He says, what bad things you've been saying to the Khalif since you've entered upon him. I mean, the Khalif has no problem. He's been praising the man. And this person is saying, what bad things you've been saying to the Amir al-Mu'mineen. فَلَقَدْ جَعَلْتَ خَلِيفَةَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ أَعْدَاءِ اللَّهِ وَآذَيْتَ. You've made the Khalifa among the enemies of Allah, and you've made him out to be so bad. فَقَالَ أَبُو حَازِمْ بَلْ بِسَمَا قُلْتَ أَنْتَ. So he turned, Abu Hazim turns to that man, he says, no, what you're saying is the worst of things. فَلَقَدْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْعُلَمَاءِ الْمِيثَاقِ بِأَنْ يَقُولُوا كَلِمَةَ الْحَقِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a covenant, has a covenant with the ulama that they should say the truth, regardless of whom it's in front of. That's a covenant Allah has with the ulama that they say the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَتُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَ. You will mention it clearly to the people, and you will not hide anything. That is the way the ulama need to be. May Allah make us of those people. ثُمَّ الْتَفَتَ إِلَى الْخَلِيفَ. Then he turned around to the Khalifa and he says, يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He explained himself to the Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ مَضَوْا قَبْلَنَا مِنْ الْأُمَمِ الْخَالِيَةِ. The people who passed before us from the past nations, ظلوا في خير وعافية ما دام أمر ما دام أمراءهم يأتون علماءهم رغبة فيما عندهم. They remained in a good state as long as their emirs and their leaders used to come to the ulama for what the ulama used to possess. They used to come to the ulama for what the ulama had and what they possessed. ثم وجد قوم. Then a certain group came up who went and studied a bit of knowledge. And then they took that knowledge to gain proximity towards the emirs and their leaders. So they themselves went to the emirs, rather than the emirs come to them, where the emirs used to go to them before. Now these new group of pseudo ulama, pseudo scholars, who learnt a bit of knowledge and then went with that to the emirs. All they wanted to gain by that was worldly goods and position. فَاسْتَعَنَتِ الْأُمَرَاءُ عَنِ الْعُلَمَاءُ فَاسْتَغَنَتِ الْأُمَرَاءُ عَنِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. And now the emirs, they became independent of the ulama, because now the ulama were coming to them. They didn't have to go to the ulama, because now they were despicable. فَتَعِسُوا وَانْكَسَبُوا. So they became denigrated in the sight of the emirs, because they're saying that, well, these people, they just want the world. They're not doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَسَقَطُوا مِنْ عَيْنِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. They also fell in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was that new generation. وَلَوْ أَنَّ الْعُلَمَاءَ زَهَّدُوا فِي مَا عِنْدَ الْعُلَمَاءَ أُمَرَاءَ. And if the ulama, they exercised abstinence from what the umara possessed, meaning what the khalifs have, la raghaba al-umara fi ilmihim. Then these khalifs and these leaders, they would long for the knowledge of these ulama. Walakinhum raghabu fi ma 'inda al-umara. But then they began to long for what the emirs had, and that's why fazahadu fihim wa hadu 'alayhim, and that's why they became despicable in their sight. The Khalifa said, Sadaqta, you have absolutely told the truth. Zidni min maw'idhatik. Tell me some more, give me some more advice, O Abu Hazim. As if he hasn't had enough advice. But he was taking the opportunity and advantage from this man. He said, give me some more advice, O Abu Hazim. فَمَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا الْحِكْمَةُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ فَمِهِ مِنْ. I've never seen anybody whose wisdom is closer to his mouth than you. I've never seen anybody with so much more wisdom than you on his tongue. فَقَالَ إِن كُنْتَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْإِسْتِجَابَةِ. Look how what Abu Hazim says to him. He says, oh, Amir al-Mu'mineen, if you are of the people who respond to nasiha, who go and act when you're told about something, فَقَدْ قُلْتُ لَكَ مَا فِيهِ كِفَايَةً. Then I've already told you sufficient. I've already given you sufficient advice. If you're of those who acts upon whatever they're told, then whatever I've told you is already sufficient. وَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُمْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. And if you're not of those people who act on advice, then فَمَا يَنْبَغِيلِي أَنْ أَرْمِي عَنْ قَوْسٍ لَيْسَ لَهَا وَطْرٍ. Then there is no point of me trying to shoot arrows from a bow that doesn't have a string. I'm wasting my time. Essentially he's saying, I'm wasting my time otherwise. I told you enough, go and act upon that. The Khalifa said, "Azamtu alayka an tusini ya Aba Hazim." I insist, I impose upon you that you give me some other nasiha, that you give me some other advice. He says, "Okay, so fa usika wa ujis." I'll give you some more advice and I'll make it brief. Azim Rabbak Azza wa Jal, wa nazzihhu an yaraka haythu nahak, wa an yafqadak haythu amarak, thumma sallama wa ansaraf. So then he said, okay, fine, I'll tell you something. He says, glorify your Lord. Glorify your Lord, Azza wa Jal, most majestic. And make tasbih of him. And make sure that he does not see you from where he has prohibited you. And make sure he doesn't find you absent where he's told you to be. Be everywhere that he's told you to be, and make sure that you're not where he's told you not to be. And then after they said, Assalamu alaikum, and he walked away. Assalamu alaikum, and he walked away. The Khalifa said, Jazakallahu khayran, min alim min nasir. May Allah reward you abundantly. Such a great advising and counseling scholar. As Abu Hazim had not even reached his house yet, where suddenly he found that behind him a man had come along from the Amir al-Mu'mineen with a whole sack full of dinar. Not dirhams, but dinar. Dinar are dinars. These are gold pieces. Dirham are silver pieces. A whole sack full of gold pieces. Can you imagine a sack full of gold pieces? What that would be, right? And he had written to him and he said, on the note it said, أَنْفِقْهَا وَلَكَ مِثْلُهَا كَثِيرٌ عِنْدِي. Spend these, distribute and spend them, and I've got like this many more for you. He returned it, and he wrote to him in response, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, أعوذ بالله أن أكون سؤالك إياي هزلا وردي عليك باطلا. Listen to this very carefully. This is his final statement. He says, he wrote that, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, I seek refuge in Allah, that you're asking me all of these questions was mockery. You're asking me all of these questions just turned to mockery, and my response to you be invalidated. فَوَاللَّهِ مَا أَرْضَى ذَٰلِكَ يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَكْ فَكَيْفَ أَرْضَاهُ لِنَفْسِي. Wallahi, I am not even satisfied with you having all of these things. So why would I be satisfied with me having those things? Do you want it that all your questions you've asked me, they're just all a joke? Is that what you're making this out to be? يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِنْ كَانَتْ هَذِهِ الدَّنَانِيرِ لِقَاءَ حَدِيثِي الَّذِي حَدَّثْتُكَ بِهِ فَالْمَيْتَةُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ فِي حَالِ الْإِضْطِرَارِ أَحَلَّ مِنْهَا. He's a faqih as well. He's a jurist as well. So he's, everything's calculated in his mind. So he refuses it. And then he also says that, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, if these dinars are in lieu of, are a payment for our meeting and the discussion that we had, then a deceased animal, and the swine's flesh, the flesh of swine, even in the state of absolute need, is more halal for me than it. وَإِنْ كَانَتْ حَقًّا لِي فِي بَيْتِ مَالِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And if this is my right from the بَيْتُ مَالِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, if this is my right from the general coffers of the Muslims, you know, of the بَيْتُ الْمَالِ, the general treasury, فَهَلْ سَوَّيْتَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ النَّاسِ جَمِيعًا فِي هَذَا الْحَقِّ. Then have you given everybody else the same amount as well? Because, you know, he's thinking, well, the Khalif might be saying, well, that's your right due to you, due to every citizen. Well, did you give everybody else as well? Now, look at these responses. I think they speak for themselves. We reflect over them because we can really associate ourselves with many aspects of these things. Yes, we're not a Khalif, and we're not a king or a governor of any sort of like that. But definitely in every other aspect, in terms of the way we live in this world, the way we approach this world and the hereafter and the general piety, we can really benefit from these things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise among us ulama like this that can counsel us in this manner and remind us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to be reminded like this and to accept it like this king and this khalif accepted it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purify our hearts within this month of Ramadan.